Hi, welcome to Live Well with Barrie, a great show about quality of life. However, this week we have two amazing guests. Ladies first, Joanna Law. Welcome.
Hello, thank you.
And Mike Vincent, a magician. Now, this is going to be special. Okay, so let's start with ladies first. Let me know about you, darling. Tell me, growing up to where you are now.
Well, it's been a long time. I just turned 50. So literally,
did
like,
you say that
the last week. Yeah.
I've been 35 for the past 15 years, okay. Anyway, go on.
So how far back do you want to go?
Oh, from the beginning.
From as far back
as you can remember.
Okay, well, I think it's important to me to say that I was born in Trinidad.
Yes, I know.
So that was an interesting thing because, and I'm proud of that, deeply proud of that, because, well, why wouldn't you be? And my dad was a vicar over there.
Right.
6 years, so that's where I was conceived and born.
And you lived there for how long?
I lived there probably for a year.
Right.
Yeah, so I don't really remember.
So you don't really have that
I don't have a memory of it, but of course we've got loads of photographs of.
Right. Where in Trinidad, do you know?
Chaguanas.
Oh, I know well.
Yeah.
My father is from there, yeah.
Okay.
So.
So that was then, and so I've grown up with a dad who's a vicar and a mum who's a professional singer. So there's been a lot of church and a lot of music in my life.
And that definitely runs through the whole Law dynasty,
doesn't it? Yeah, yeah. And I often think I am the product of those two.
Right.
So I've lived quite a sort of dual life.
Okay.
So I've always done sort of more than one thing.
So let's start with Mother's career as a singer.
Yeah.
Where was she singing? What was she doing?
Well, she was a classical singer.
Right.
So she...
Opera?
Opera and sort of oratorio.
Oratorio, yeah.
Yeah. So she did a lot of solo work.
Okay.
But then when she got married, she sort of became more of a sort of... mum at home.
Naturally.
But still did loads and loads of singing and was always off going here, there and everywhere singing. And and ran church choirs. So I've always sung in a church choir.
Right, so you have a very strong memory of that from this high.
Oh yeah.
Singing in church and
yeah. And it wasn't a choice, you know, we didn't get a choice. That's what we did.
Right.
I mean, so it just was part of our lives, but it was something that we kind of all grew up doing.
And your three brothers were involved in that as well?
Yeah, yeah.
The three famous brothers?
Should we say.
Infamous, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, so they were involved in it as well?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We've all been doing that for as long as I can remember.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you came back to England. Where did you grow up in England?
Well, we came back to somewhere in Shropshire first, and then my dad, we moved, and this is where I can start remembering properly, we moved to Suffolk, and I grew up in Suffolk for quite a long time, until I was 16, and then we moved to a church in Essex, so, yeah.
Moving closer to London.
London.
And
then
London.
I then went to university in London.
Okay, then.
Yeah.
That's right, because you went to Goldsmiths.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
and what did you study at Goldsmiths?
I studied sociology.
Okay.
The only reason I went to Goldsmiths was because I wanted to be in London and I wanted to do singing. So what I studied didn't really matter. It was just that I could get to London and be in London.
Right.
So I was a very bad student. Yeah.
The creatives always are.
Yeah, very bad.
The creatives always are.
And didn't really do much work. But
you got through it.
It allowed me to do other things. And it was a great place to be, actually, to be fair.
Goldsmiths is amazing.
I met some wonderful people there who are still my friends now, all the years later.
So when were you there?
1986 to 1989.
Right.
Yeah, it was around the time of, you know, Brit Art, Damien Hirst.
That's right, yeah.
He came to one of our parties, you know, all that crowd. It was amazing. It was a really amazing time.
So, right, having studied sociology, what then brought you to the music career? Because this is what we have to talk about.
Well, no, because I think this is what I mean by the sort of two strands of life going parallel. I think I've always had an aspect of my life which is sort of caring about society, caring about people, caring about the world we live in, and that I've always felt very deeply about that. And I think that comes probably from having a dad who's an amazing spiritual person,
right?
But at the same time, running parallel to that is my mum, who was incredibly creative, incredibly talented musician, and living with music sort of 24/7, really, because she did.
Yeah.
And so it's a bit of a mix. It's a bit of an interesting.
So the two
mix.
Strands. Tell me about the two strands.
Yeah. So. So now I've done lots of things, but now I work as a psychotherapist, family psychotherapist.
Okay.
So, and I work with mainly young people with mental health problems and their families.
Right.
And
the effects it has on the family.
Yeah. And I it's an amazing job. It's just, it's stressful, but it's really rewarding. And I really enjoy it, and I think I'm pretty good at it too, you know. So I do that, but I also really, really still enjoy making music, and I do that at every opportunity I can get. So.
So when did you first start making music, recording, and when was that?
My brother Simon and I probably made our first recording when we were back in sort of 87, maybe, 1987.
And what was that?
It was a song called Love Is Not Enough.
Right.
And it was actually, it won a sort of competition, and then it was actually released in this country and in the States. So it's a beautiful song. It's an old song now, but it's still really beautiful. And that was the first one we did properly together. It's true, isn't it? Or was there something before then?
I don't know.
I lose track a little bit, to be honest. But that was the one that was properly signed and released. And,
okay.
Yeah.
So who were you signed to at the time?
Chrysalis.
Chrysalis?
We got a deal with Chrysalis. And interestingly, the guy who's, I think I'm right in saying, the guy who signed us is now runs a label called Donor Records.
Right.
And that's the label that my brother Simon has got a record coming out with this year.
Yeah, we'll get to the famous Simon Law in a second.
Yeah.
But your first solo single that went big is...
Well, I did a cover version of The First Time Ever I Saw Your Face.
And you all know it, believe me.
Yeah. And, you know, that's wherever I have to, you know, and I'm being very sincere and honest, wherever I've been in the world, and I've done a bit of travelling, I've always met people who know that record, my version.
Yes.
I mean, we all know that it's an amazing song, and the amazing singers have sung it. But I've sort of been in the most bizarre places, and I've said, I'm Joanna Law. What, the Joanna Law that sang First Time Ever? Yes. And it's quite incredible, you know, that a lot of people know that tune,
yeah.
Who love music. So I feel very blessed to have done that, because it's meant a lot of things to me.
I mean, it's still played in parties now.
Yeah.
It's still a popular party tune now.
And quite a lot of people have said that they've made their children to it, which I think is the most wonderful thing
tribute
anybody could say. I, I, conceived a child to that record, I'm thinking, that's so cool. So I just love it.
So, the famous Law dynasty, big brother, Simon, so he's in Canada now.
Yeah.
And he has released, or is releasing.
Yeah.
An album, is it?
It is, and it's amazing because there's so wonderful singers on it. So there's Karen Wheeler from, you know, Soul to Soul.
Well, indeed, because he co-wrote the famous Back to Life with Jazzy B.
Yeah.
So,
So he's done a lot of work with Jazzy over the years. So there's Karen on this record. There's Maxi Priest. There's Lane Gray, who used to sing with New Colours.
Okay.
Amazing singer. Gosh, who else? Oh, Shantae Moore.
Really?
And a number of other people. Nadine Sutherland, I don't know her too well, but she's a reggae artist.
Right.
But she's done a
And that's due out when?
I think, and me actually, I must say. I've got a song on the album.
Right.
So that's out, I think, in June.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It is. It's amazing because, you know, he's been able to bring together lots of people.
Lots of people. Great collaboration.
Yeah.
Big names in. But you said that you are now a psychologist.
Psychotherapist. Yeah.
What made you leave the music to go and study again? Because obviously you had to study again to become a psychotherapist at this stage of the game.
Yeah.
What made you do that? What was your inspiration to do that?
Well, I guess what inspired me to become a family therapist is that my family is pretty complicated. We've had, as are many families, we've had some ups and downs and ins and outs. And over the years, over the years, I just started to think, what is all this about? What is family life about? What are relationships about? And I think like that. I do think strange things and think carefully about things. So I was looking into sort of different therapies, and I thought I'd really like to do that and study that. And an opportunity arose for me to do it. So I got the first half paid for, which was great. So you have to do it in two sections. So it's a diploma, a postgraduate diploma, and then a master's degree. So I did them both, and it was over 4 years. And it's a lot of heavy studying. But I got there. I got there in the end. It was hard. But, and I think it's just about me wanting to find meaning.
To what's going on, particularly
relationships, you know. Relationships are complicated. And it's really broadened my thinking about how people live their lives and the relationships they get into. And, you know, I'm less judgmental now about people, definitely. Right. And again, I just love the work. I love working with people. Yeah, so.
Yeah. So, and now, to present day, you've come back into music. As you said, you'd never left, but for that period that you were studying, those 2 years, between 2012 and 14, you put the music to bed.
Yeah, put it to the side for a bit.
Yeah, so now you're only too glad to pull back the covers and pull it out and start all over again.
Well, I think in amongst all of this, I always write, so I have periods of time where I don't write. But actually, I can't help myself. I always come up with lyrics and writing songs and melodies. And, you know, and when that happens, I have to do something with it. So recently, I've had a bit of a sort of phase of writing songs. And I find my life experiences influence that as well. So personal experiences, people I meet, you know, experience I have work doing the work that I do, it really inspires me to write. So it's not something I have.
So you've always been writing. You've got a stack of stuff there.
It's not something I can kind of stop. It's like I have to do it. If I didn't do it, I'd probably burst.
Almost like a compulsion.
And musicians and artists and people I speak to, you know, they say that it's like, well, I don't have a choice. I just have to do it.
Right.
It's not about what happens after that. Although, as you know, I've got a bit of a band together now.
So
I'm going to be doing some live gigs. Small. I don't want anything big, but some more intimate sort of gigs. And I'm really excited. I thought maybe I wouldn't do any more, but I'm definitely going to do some more now.
So it's live gigs you're going to do? Are you going to do any recording? Are you looking to do that?
Yeah. I'll do I'll do sort of an EP, a long EP, of my new songs. Yeah.
And when are you looking to kind of have that out for our wonderful ears?
Well, maybe realistically, probably towards the end of this year, I'd say. Yeah. Right. But what I'd like to do is to do some live gigs before then.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Great.
Such is my life,
So, with all the pressures of life that you have, because clearly you're a busy person with music, a family, you know, parents involved, and the psychotherapist, have to get that right. What do you do to take care of yourself to keep your mind in a healthy place?
Well, that's a really good question. And I mean, my belief is that if you're a therapist, which is what I am now, I don't feel that therapists can do therapy without having had therapy or been in therapy. Right. So I do have a therapist myself who I am, you know, really pleased to have found someone who is very helpful to me, helps me think about my life, but also my work and how everything connects.
Fits together.
I take that sort of thing very seriously, and I don't think I could do without that, because if you're doing the kind of work that you do, and if you have a bit of a complex life, which I do, I need that.
And how often do you have to have that therapy, is it?
Well, I don't have to have it. I choose to have it.
Yeah.
I do that sort of every 2 or 3 weeks.
Right.
Yeah.
As frequently as that.
Yeah.
And you feel that keeps your equilibrium to just deal with everything that's going on?
Yeah.
And not affect you in a negative way?
It's about taking care of myself.
That's absolutely the rule of life, isn't it? Because if you don't take care of yourself and you're not on top form, you're no good to anybody else.
Yes, exactly.
Not to your family, not to the people that you're supposed to be helping in your job. You know, you've got to keep healthy.
Yeah.
And in a good place.
Yeah. So that's one aspect. I mean, that's about my mind. As you know, Barry, I'm not great at doing lots of exercise and things, but I've turned over a bit of a new leaf recently, and I've started to work with a trainer, and I'm doing some more.
That isn't mean, by the way.
But it's a woman, actually. But I'm starting to feel like I'm starting to get back into it, which is the key. And I'm starting to really feel that it's benefiting me. Whereas before I got into a bit of a situation where I thought, I don't think I can do this anymore.
Right.
Whereas now I'm thinking, yes, I can, I really can, and it's really doing me a lot of good.
Well, that's great. I mean,
yeah.
And that's why you have a personal trainer, because they're supposed to motivate and inspire you every time you see them. And even when they leave you or you leave them, it's the support network in between the next session that keeps you on track with the exercise, the eating, and everything. So that's good to hear.
I just need to kick up the butt as well, really. But you give me that as well. But, you know.
I don't know what you're talking about. Look at his face. Does this look like a face that kicks anyone?
Yes.
Mike, let me bring you in the game.
Hi,
lovely
Barrie.
To have you.
No, that was very interesting.
Lovely to have you.
Thank you.
The magician. I'm really quite excited because I've never met a magician before. I feel like I'm at a children's party. So, tell me, you're partially deaf?
Yes.
Partially deaf?
I lost my hearing 5 years ago.
Right.
Yeah.
So, that changes it all, because I wasn't sure if you were born without hearing or if it came later. What was the cause of it?
Well, you've just said something very interesting. If someone's born deaf, that's a different experience to losing the hearing you
have. I'm sure.
I panicked. I went to bed one night. I woke up the following morning, sudden dramatic hearing loss. That's what the doctor told me. He said I was the fifth person that came in that day with this thing. But it didn't happen suddenly. I noticed that my hearing was diminishing 2-3 years prior. I've got tinnitus as well. Some people have a ringing sensation. Mine sounds like a jumbo jet engine. On a good day, it's a mild rumble. On a bad day, it's severely aggressive and I cannot think straight.
And that is continuous?
24/7.
So how do you sleep with that, or is it just something you become accustomed to?
I keep my mind occupied so I don't think about it.
Right.
So that's part of the question you asked, Joe. How do I keep myself mentally healthy? It does my head in on a bad day. Okay, but you know what?
Well, we all have bad days. Yeah. So that's called being human.
So when I lost my hearing, it was a huge adjustment period. And being a deaf magician as well.
You're quite a novelty.
Well, you know what? I'm not the only one.
Wow.
Really?
All right. There were magicians at the Magic Circle who were deaf. I know this because I was friendly with them when I had hearing. I'd see the person on stage signing for them when there was a lecture on, for example. And I was always intrigued. These guys loved magic. They would be at the Magic Circle every Monday. They're Victor signed, wonderful gentleman, silver white hair, and he's there watching, signing. I was always impressed with that. I never told anybody this, but I thought, wow, if you love something, you engage in it. Mm. Doesn't matter. Do you know what saved me?
Tell me.
I have a reputation as being one of the best sleight of hand magicians in the world. I don't worry about that. That's other people's opinion of me. But I can sit here and say, with no ego, I do magic very well. Okay, that's a fact. Let me celebrate that, okay? But I don't want to stay there. When I lost my hearing, I had to go out and do a show the following night. With no sound. I couldn't even hear the audience talk back to me. I couldn't hear the applause. I had to act natural. Mm. I got one question answered. I could still function and do my show.
Right.
The audience could hear me. What happened was I had no volume control. My voice boomed the whole room. Okay, and people would tell me, calm down. It threw me slightly, but at least I knew, okay, I could still stand up and do my show. But I had to overcome the psychological challenge of being deaf. So I thought back to a magician named Brother Hammond. He's dead now. He suffered polio, but he became a sleight of hand master in a wheelchair.
Right.
I thought of the great René Lavande. He passed away. He lost his right hand when he was 9 years old. He was already practicing magic two-handed. But he lost his right hand as a small boy. Can you imagine the trauma of a nine-year-old boy having to relearn everything with one hand? He became a grandmaster.
Wow.
Richard Turner, still alive. He's blind. But he does the most exquisite handling with cards I've ever seen on the planet. Okay, so I thought, what right do I have to give up? Mm. All right, I can't hear, but at least the audience can still hear me. I can get out of bed, I can still function, I can brush my teeth, I can put my shirt and tie on, and I can still practice. I just need to find a way to still express myself in spite of being deaf. I'm a graduate of Landmark Education. It's the greatest personal development program I've ever done. And they teach us distinctions about how we handle the challenges of life. And I thought, how can Landmark's training help me right now being deaf? The number one thing they taught us, you don't listen. They told us that straight away. You guys just don't listen. You're listening to your internal commentary about what's being said, but you're not really listening
to what you're being told.
Exactly.
Right.
So I got present to something, Barrie. I thought, I may have lost my hearing, but it doesn't mean I can't listen. Hearing is a function of the ear mechanics working properly. Listening is a function of the mind, and my mind was healthy. I could still listen, but I could listen in a way that I've never done before. And it goes beyond body language. In fact, body language is part of it, but it's not the be-all and end-all. It's what's known as multi-sensory listening. You could be telling me stuff, but I'm watching how you're being about what you're telling me. That's where the truth is, so you can't lie to me.
Right.
I had this skill as a little boy because my mother told me, you were so straight with people. I used to be embarrassed. She used to tell me, oh, I don't like you. What's he doing there? Get lost. Six-year-old, very precocious. But here's the point. I spoke the truth because I had a feeling or a vibe from people. Remember the empath we spoke about? Very powerful skill. So when I lost my hearing, being in a world of silence, guess what? My other senses
became more acute. Yeah.
Just like a Jedi Knight. I was in tune with something different. And you know what? I thought, you know, maybe there's a reason for this. I really need to pay attention to things in a way that I've never done before. So I actually accepted it fairly quickly. I struggled. I got frustrated. Fortunately, I didn't get depressed about it.
Well, all of that says something about your mentality and attitude, how you use those people that you mentioned earlier as inspiration to keep going.
Absolutely.
Rather than being in the situation of feeling sorry for yourself. You were like, well, they're people that are worse off than myself that kept going and reached heights that, you know, I can only hope to reach. Mm-hmm. And you used it as inspiration.
Yeah.
That's great. What was your first experience with magic? What got you into magic?
Okay. Just to create the context for what you just said, I was born in 1964. I'm an Aquarian, Valentine's Day, Year of the Dragon. And my mother, the following week, she came out of hospital with me. She's watching Cassius Clay fight Sonny Liston on television, holding me in the arm. That was a very important point in this conversation because I'll mention it again in a little moment. I'm an only child, no father in the home. My mother raised me single-handedly.
Right.
Church every Sunday. She made my own clothes, shirt and tie. No father. I saw my first magician in 1970, David Nixon.
Oh,
was that ring about?
Yes, I remember David Nixon.
David Nixon, Doug Henning. I love watching the magicians on television, but I didn't start engaging with the subject. 1974, I remember it like it was yesterday. I'm in the cinema watching Paul Newman and Robert Redford in The Sting. Yeah. The story of con men, gamblers, grifters.
Yeah.
That film, my brain went, whoa! Because they showed you card cheating in the film. I was so attracted to that. I went to the library and I asked the librarian, do you have any books on card tricks? And she showed me some books in the library. Now, this is important. We live in an age now where there is so much information available. I did the obvious thing. I went to the library because I wanted to find out how to do these things with cards. So I started reading magic books on my own. As an only child, You can speak to anyone as an only child. You create your own world. You create your own fantasy, because I didn't fit in anywhere. I was getting bullied at school. I was getting into fights every day. I was not a happy boy growing up. Mm. Once I started practicing card tricks, everything changed. Because I had a crossroad moment. My school teacher, Mr. Hamilton, he was my woodwork teacher. I said to him, sir, I want these fights to stop. I don't want to come to school and be getting beaten up every day. This is true, I was getting beaten up every day. He said, Michael, you can do something that nobody else can do. I know you're good at card magic, magic trick. You're going to do the school assembly. I said, what? He inspired me to go on stage and do the school assembly for the whole school.
How old were you then?
14.
Mm-hmm. Right, secondary school.
I did the show, got the ovation. They went bananas. Something happened to my brain. I did a very quick neurological calculation. I said to myself, if I could be a good magician, I could survive the bullying, the victimization. So I used the magic to keep the bullies at bay. When they wanted to do me in, pick a card. That was my pattern interrupt. And you know all about pattern interrupts, right? Mm-hmm. And it worked. Something else happened to me. I saw the impact I was having. I became interested in influencing people.
All right.
And I became interested in the psychology of influencing, deception, and the psychology of human behavior. So alongside my interest in magic, I was interested in what goes on in the brain when you watch a magician at work. I didn't realize it at the time, but I just wanted to fit in and belong without being hassled.
As any child at that
stage would. But it gave me an extra layer of power, and my ego went into overdrive. This is important. 15-year-old with a massive ego, you're not going to mess with me. Pick a card, let's try something. And I could see they were humbled in that moment by a simple card trick. So I used that to my advantage. My life changed for the better when I walked into a magic shop and I wanted to buy some magic books, but the gentleman that owned the shop, I didn't know who he was. His name was Alan Allen. And he said to me, you're very interested in the books. He says, why is that? I said, well, I got most of them from the library, but I want my own copy. Mm. And so I bought the Harry Lorraine Book of Magic. Now, Harry Lorraine is, he's still alive, the world's greatest expert in memory training. Mm. But he wrote books for magicians because he was a great card man. He became my hero because I read his magic book as a young boy. I wrote this man a letter. Guess what, Barrie? He wrote me back. I got a letter from Harry Lorraine.
Well, he must have been so thrilled to see that somebody was that interested to write him.
His address was in the book.
Yeah.
New York, 62 James Street. So that began a correspondence with someone that I'd read about. Here's the funny thing. I met all of my heroes because of the books I read. Thanks to Alan, he orchestrated a few things that made it possible for me to meet some really extraordinary people. Mm-hmm. Do you remember the film Zulu with Michael Caine?
Correct, yeah.
The director of that film was a gentleman called Seinfeld. One Saturday afternoon, Alan closed the shop at 2 o'clock. He said, we're going somewhere. I said, where are we going? It's a surprise. We head down to Old Compton Street. I'm about 15. We go into Valerie's Patisserie. It's still there. We walk in at the back. I see this old man shuffling a pack of cards. He says, Michael, I'd like to introduce you to a very good friend of mine. This is Seinfeld. A Hollywood movie director. So we sat down. I said, I've got your book. I said, I think it's a great book. Can you show me something? I said, sure. So I did one of the tricks for him. grown man. He was such a wonderful man. And I knew him right until his death around 1994, 95. Had a wonderful relationship with him. Let me tell you about, he directed Stanley Baker, Michael Caine. He was an inventor. He invented a thing called the micro writer. We talk about iPads and things today. He invented a device for people who were blind so they could type. He invented a chess set where the pieces form together to make a magic wand. And he also created some of the most beautiful card tricks ever. And he wrote a book called Seinfeld's Entertaining Card Magic, which was published before I was born, mid-50s. What I loved about Enfield, he directed me like he directed his actors. So I'd show him tricks and he said, okay, let's look at how you deliver it, the presentation, the scripting. So it's like learning to pat your head and rub your tummy at the same time, executing intricate sleight of hand, but presenting it in a way like a narrative and a nice story that people will find entertaining. Okay, so I'm grateful to him, I'm grateful to Alan, because he took me on a journey into a world of...
So what age is this?
I'm 15, 16. 15. And here's the beautiful thing. As a teenager, I was engaged in a quality of conversation most teenagers don't have.
Weren't privy to, yeah. Mm.
He was talking to me about communication, posture, standing straight. We would study videos of Pavarotti. I said to him, what has this got to do with magic? He said, everything. Yeah. Just shut up and watch. So I'm watching Pavarotti singing Ness and Dorma, Return to Surrey. I think I'm bored out of my skull, but I'm watching it. Would you believe I cultivated a real interest in opera? Something happened. Yeah. I listened to, he would play Nat King Cole, Frank Sinatra. I love all music, by the way, but Louis Armstrong. We would watch videos of Louis Armstrong. I said, look at this. He would show me, look at how straight he stands, such dignity.
Showing you showmanship.
Oh, yeah. Man, it was a beautiful thing. And I thought, I want to look like that. You're just a young boy.
Now you're a magician full time, but you said earlier that you weren't, that wasn't your first job.
No, I was a postman.
Right, so when did you start being a postman and when did you give up?
I was a postman in 1985.
Okay.
Until 1991.
And that's when you just decided...
I said, I just want to do something for the rest of my life that makes me happy.
Yeah.
It wasn't about money, and I wasn't happy being a postman. Sometimes it's better to be ignorant, because if I had known what laid ahead, I probably would not have done it.
Right.
So I learned, because learning to work for yourself is another discipline. And that was back in the day when I had to write my own letters, go out and market myself before the computer age. I couldn't even type one finger. I can handle a deck of cards better than a typewriter.
So you made magic a career win?
1991. That's when I turned professional. Mm. Yeah. And I had an old thinking mentality because I thought, you know, get a manager, have good agents. It was effective to a degree, but there was something missing. I don't know. I probably had it in the back of my mind that I'd be on television, become famous, all of that nonsense. And I thought, it didn't happen. I didn't get discouraged, but it did raise a few questions for me. Okay, what's my career about? And then things shifted when I discovered the internet. And now we're in 2017. If there's one thing I've noticed, I've had to evolve with the changing times.
Well, I think most people really do, what they get left behind. Because times are going to continue to change whether you keep up or not. Exactly. And you find that you just end up being left behind.
I'm going to say something radical. For me, at least. All the work that I have done over the last 20 years, right now, it doesn't matter.
Right.
It's not going to give me the kind of life that I want to create moving forward. Who I was last week is old news. I've got to be constantly in a space of creation.
And evolving.
Moment by moment, yeah. Day by day, without any attachment to who I was 10 minutes ago. So everything I've said in the last 10 minutes, forget about it. It's done.
Okay, show on.
The point, though, what's important is, okay, I'm present to a few things. What experience am I creating right now in this conversation? How is my communication and your communication, Joe, impacting the listener? Do they feel something positive from you, from me? Mm-hmm. Does it give them a different point of view about the world they're living or how they're currently living life? Can we say something that's real, authentic, that can make a difference?
Well, that's the whole purpose of what this show is about.
Oh,
being inspirational and being real.
Yeah.
And showing that, you know, everybody has something that they can develop and be something that they want to be, rather than just being something that they feel they have to be with no option.
All right. Yeah.
So now tell me about the academy.
Well, the academy you're referring to is something I created while I was a student of Landmark Education. I was inside their work for 6 years because I was so fascinated with what they taught. On one of the programs, we got to create a project. So I thought, I had just done Penn and Teller with Jonathan Ross.
Mm-hmm.
I started getting emails from magicians around the world. Do you teach? I thought, what's going on here? We saw you on Penn and Teller. We love the way you work. How can you be so calm on television doing such technical stuff? These were the questions I was getting. So I began to think, well, look, okay, yeah, I can teach. I said, yes. And I thought, I created the academy out of that program I was on, the Vincent Academy. And my intention with the academy is to leave the craft, the magic, better than I found it. How do I do that? Well, my greatest legacy won't be my work, it will help, but it will be my students. My students.
Like every teacher, isn't it? It's not about what you do, it's about what you leave them with, that they move forward and develop and make a difference.
Can my students be part of the conversation? Let me tell you, it's the most wonderful thing when a student comes to me and, sure, they want to learn magic, but I'm hearing a concern in the background that they haven't spoken about. There may be a lack of confidence, a self-esteem issue. The great magician Michael Skinner once said that magic attracts the socially inadequate.
Is that so?
I was shy. Mm-hmm. I was getting bullied. I needed to find a leverage where I could stand out. One of the primary human needs is significance, the need to be important. Mm-hmm. Magic makes an individual feel important. Look at me. Look at what I can do. And if you stay on that path, your ego goes into overdrive. It happens to all of us, but some of us come out another tunnel. I think, right, there's got to be more to it than just me. What about the audience? What can I create for them? What can I give away to someone else? My academy is all about making a difference. Some of my students are truly wonderful. They created their own show. They now can stand up and perform magic impeccably well. Sure, I taught them, but let me give them credit. They had to do the work. They had to put themselves through a discipline, practice approach.
And they've taken what you've given them.
Precisely.
Put their own personalities and characters.
Exactly.
They've made that specific thing their own, even though you gave them the foundation. They've made it their own thing with their own personality. It's
tough.
Like all creators, really.
I'm as tough with them as Alan was with me. Mm. However, I see potential. I think, you know what? Why don't you try it this way? How does that feel? I get them to tell me, how do you feel while you're doing that? Okay. Leave your ego to one side. Tell me the truth. I want an authentic dialogue with my students. When you're doing a trick for your audience, what experience are you leaving them with? I go watch them, I'm evaluating, I'm listening to the audience, and I'm seeing the experience they give the audience. It's the most extraordinary process, because I know when I was a young boy, I thought I was crap, and this is the truth. Alan used to bash me to pieces with his advice and criticism. I used to leave his flat in tears, and I thought, I'll never be a good magician. Sure, I can do the tricks, but he's always nitpicking.
But it's that critiquing that makes you the great musician, isn't it? Or a magician, or whatever.
It's all of that, but I'm going to say something interesting about why I kept going back. Alan was the closest thing I will ever know to a father figure, and I was looking for his approval. He's dead now. And I will give thanks to him for until the day I die. And I have to acknowledge him in that capacity, because he really was like that. We all showed love differently, but from the moment he engaged me, that was an act of love. Mm-hmm. It was an act of love. And the conversations we had, I've never spoken like that with any other human being. We would be talking, we actually spoke about black people. What does it mean to be a black magician? I said, Alan, I'm going to be a black magician. Do you think people will like me? Because the first thing they're going to see is a black man, not a magician. He says, well, one or two things can happen. They can call you a black man. But, or you can present yourself with class and dignity like Louis Armstrong, the Nicholas Brothers, and make people colorblind with your talent. Mm. What do you choose?
What a beautiful sentence. Mm. Well, beautiful sentence. Perfectly put.
That's the anchor he gave me.
Amazing.
Oh, it was. I'm present to it now. I didn't realize it at the time, but he inspired me. And one of my students, he's from Hong Kong. Most of my students are in Europe, but thanks to the internet, I coached them through Skype. And we have those types of conversations.
Well, how times have changed.
Considerably.
You can coach somebody in Hong Kong.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Now, are you going to grace us with some magic?
I can create something for you right now, if you like.
Quick, I can't wait any longer.
No. All right, would you like to help me with this?
Yeah.
All right, okay.
Sure would.
I'm pretending to be a grown-up now.
All right, I know we're on candid camera here. Can I see your hand for a second, Joe? Oh, that's very nice, yeah. Got a very good money line, by the way.
Can you make that ring disappear and come onto my finger? Sorry.
Does your job pay well?
No.
Oh, okay, well, I'll tell you what, just for you, I'm going to lace your palm with a little bit of silver.
Ooh.
These are pure silver dollars. Okay, keep that nice and steady. Now, the beautiful thing, this is going to happen in your hand. All right, you can confirm how many have you got there?
Four.
All right, with your other hand, just square the coins up like a stack of poker chips. Okay, very good. Now, close your right hand tightly around them. Okay. Now, since you've got them, I can't cheat. Okay, turn your hand over. Barrie, they say the will is strong, but the flesh is weak. Are you ready? Did you feel anything? Look at this.
No.
Through flesh and bone. I tried not to leave any bumps or bruises. Did you feel anything?
No.
Turn your hand over. Did it work?
Oh, stop that.
Oh, stop it.
That. Stop that.
No.
I'm trying to be a grown up here, but you're making it very difficult.
That's all.
Did you see that? Four turned into three, literally, before my eyes.
Oh my gosh.
In a moment, one of these will leave my hand and join this one. How would you like it, visibly or invisibly?
I'm going to pass out if you keep this up.
Visibly or invisibly?
Or what do you think, Joe?
Invisibly.
Invisibly.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you
keep
what.
The misty.
If you listen, you'll actually hear when the next one arrives, okay? So watch this. Are you ready? Watch. Did you hear that? The eagle has landed.
I'm going to pass out. I don't think I can take much more of it.
Did you realise my hand was closer just a second?
Yeah.
I was doing this the other night. There was a lady in the front who says, Michael, can you do it without closing your hand? I want to see the moment the coin leaves one hand and joins the other. Look, nothing else in my hands. Okay. I think it was Elton John who said the space between the notes creates the music. Here's the space between my fingertips. It creates the magic.
I'm going to faint if he keeps this up.
Here's the last one. make a fist. We're right back where we started. How many have you got?
Four.
How many do I have?
None.
Open in just enough so I can reach in with my finger and thumb. I'll take that last one out, squeeze tightly. Nothing can get in or get out. Sleeves rolled up. Ready? I'm like a ghost vanishing through the walls of an old, old castle. I tried not to hit the sides.
No.
Take a look.
Oh my gosh. This is crazy. This is crazy. We are with a proper magician here. Make no mistake.
I am in awe.
Sitting here and things are happening to me that I can't explain. Whoa.
Do you know something? I wouldn't normally do this.
Go on then.
But I want to do it one more time, okay?
Okay.
Drop this hand. Look at this. Very fairly. Look, this one's for me. Hold these, squeeze tightly, upside down. Do you like travelling?
Yeah.
Is there anywhere in the world you'd like to go that you haven't been to yet?
Thailand.
That's really far. How would you feel if I could make this silver coin change places with the local currency in Bangkok right now?
And that would be the end of me. You'd be taking me to casualty.
Well, you could have named any country in the world.
Yes.
Wash my hands. And you know what they say? This is all about foreign exchange. Look at this. I'm not sure what dynasty that is.
Oh my gosh.
But here's the best part. People think this is just a clever magic trick. But you could have named any country in the world.
No.
You said
yes.
Thailand.
Yes, I did.
This wasn't prearranged.
No, absolutely this, 100% not.
This is real foreign exchange. Take a look.
In my hand?
Yeah.
No.
Now people know Barry Thomas. Barry Thomas is never lost for words.
No.
He's never lost for words. He's always got a comeback. He's always got the last word. I'm done. It's over.
He didn't know, could not possibly know that I would have said Thailand. Not possibly. You're amazing! Wow! Oh my gosh!
You look so cute when you're speechless.
I understand now, I understand. Oh my goodness.
How can you be hosting a talk show and be lost for words? That means conversation done. Mike, you're amazing.
Thank you.
Yes.
Now, website information, please.
Okay. If you're interested in my magic, that's michaelvincentmagic.com. If you're interested in learning magic, or if you're interested in personal development or coaching, it'll be thevincentacademy.co.uk. If you're interested in my photography, then I am thefujiwarrior.com.
Let's have the website again. Address?
All three of them?
All three of them.
MichaelVincentMagic.com, VincentAcademy.co.uk, FujiWarrior.com, and those are my Instagram addresses as well, okay?
Right. Now, Joe, where can we get hold of your music?
I can't understand.
It's insane.
That really...
I'm just trying to keep order in this studio right
keep
now.
Order.
I'm trying to keep order. I can't even sing.
Can I just say that I mean, that was an impulsive thing that I said.
Yeah.
I said Thailand.
There are loads of countries
that I would like to visit.
He could never have known.
But I have not been there and I want to go there. And yet, that...
It's amazing, it's just amazing. But back to you now, young lady. When can we get hold of your new music?
That's a good question. I don't know yet. It's not done.
It's not cooked.
It's not cooked.
It's still cooking.
All I can say is my brother's record will be out in June.
Okay.
On Dome Records,
right.
Which is a beautiful, small British soul label. And my voice will be on there in a number of ways. My own music will probably come later, probably autumn time, I'd say.
Okay, well, we'll be looking out for that.
Yeah.
Now, my last question to you, Mike, is, as I asked Joe, with all the pressures of life and the busyness and the frantic schedules, what do you do to keep yourself in a good place, both mentally and physically? What is your mechanism? What is it you
All right, let's deal with the physical side first. Me personally, I hate going to the gym. I'd rather be out taking photographs or practicing a new magic trick. However, I recognize the need for movement, so I walk everywhere.
Okay.
I don't own a car. I don't want to own a car. So walking is my number one form of exercise, especially when I'm doing street photography. I can clock 5 miles easily without breaking sweat with my camera. All right. I swim when I feel like it, but predominantly I stretch. To keep a healthy state of mind, I meditate. I like sitting still for at least 45 minutes doing nothing. Mm. I need to get over the first 10 minutes to stop the thoughts. Then eventually I reach a space where there is no thought, no mind, just being. But there's more. To keep myself in a healthy state of mind, I rely on everything I learned as a student and graduate of landmark education. The most elegant conversation on human psychology I have ever encountered. When I'm confronted by something, it could be my finances, it could be the death of 3 people close to me recently, all committing suicide. I started to begin an inquiry because I noticed my happiness left me. I thought, why? Why would someone end their life? I started to feel really, really down. I started to speak to people. And it was amazing, the conversations we had. That interrupted my pattern of thought. Conversations with people I trust keep me healthy. I'm not afraid to be vulnerable with people. Vulnerability has connotations of being weak, but no.
I think that is one of the most important things that anyone has ever said. It is that being comfortable with being vulnerable.
Yeah.
That immediately takes the pressure off.
Yeah.
Because trying to constantly be the right one, have the last word, being viewed in this way, I'm strong, I'm powerful, I don't have any weaknesses, I don't love, I don't care, that in itself is pressure.
I'm going to be honest about myself. I can fly off the handle in a heartbeat. That's just a dynamic of my personality.
Yeah, but that's because you care and you're passionate about things. And
but this goes back to me when I was being bullied at school. If I feel someone's being hostile towards me, I react. But I react without responsibility. It's not a nice thing. I don't like going into that space. So I'm really practicing. Okay, Mike, what's hooking you? I'm being responsible. And to keep my mental state healthy, instead of doing this, pointing and blaming, something I learned. The minute you start pointing and blaming, there's 3 fingers pointing back. I call these the fingers of responsibility. What am I not willing to be responsible for? The minute I ask that question, it interrupts my pattern. Something I learned from Tony Robbins, pattern interrupt. It's easy to interrupt someone else's pattern, but what do you do to interrupt your own pattern? Magic question, what can I be responsible for? You have to start finding an answer the minute you ask that question. Okay? So that keeps me healthy and I start the inquiry. Who can I speak to? I'll speak to my mother. I'll speak to some close friends of mine. I pray to the gods that may be. I recite Invictus every day. You know this poem? Oh, William Henley? Yeah. That's my anchor. It's a beautiful, beautiful Victorian poem. Because the man who wrote, he was suffering. But he realized, in spite of his suffering, he was alive.
Yeah.
And he had a powerful spirit. I read good books. I just finished reading for the 2nd time The Godfather by Putzer. But I read it to understand the nature of the people involved, and I saw so much I didn't see before, and I learned something of value. To answer your question, to keep a healthy state in mind, don't make threats. Be reasonable with people. Mm-hmm. Be reasonable with yourself. Be compassionate with yourself. Have compassion for yourself. We're human beings. We're not perfect. I might be a great magician, but I can be an idiot at times.
Well, that's called being human. But I think you embrace that vulnerability, and that's what keeps you your equilibrium and keeps you on a level, which is important. Yeah. A lot of people are scared of being even seen to be vulnerable, as I said, on care and love, and because they feel it puts them in a weak spot.
And that connects a little bit with what I was saying about sort of being less judgmental.
Yeah.
And I think when you're sort of, for me, when, you know, growing up within the church sort of context, which I was, and that was fine, but I think that can often bring a sort of level of sort of judgment, you know, being too overly judgmental of people.
Absolutely.
And I've had to work hard to really understand and to lessen that, and, you know, and to think very differently. So I'm a very different person than I was then.
I was fascinated listening to your story, because you grew up, you were born in a very beautiful part of the world.
Yeah.
So you've got a real distinction for, even though you don't remember it.
Yeah.
It's in there.
Yeah.
And the fact that you're in the arts like I am, it's the most wonderful privilege to create music, to create magic and make people feel good with it.
Yes.
Music and magic bends people's reality. And it shifts their state. Mm. The one thing I miss is enjoying my music, because I can't hear it in the way that I used to. That's the one thing I miss.
Mm.
And I'm talking right across the board, everything. Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know what? It's such a powerful part of my life. When I lost my hearing, I could hear Nat King Cole playing the piano. I could hear Sinatra singing. It was so clear, I thought it was a radio. Where's the radio coming from? No, I heard it in my head, like I was in a concert. That really upset me.
It's engraved in you from,
your memory.
It's engraved.
It was a big part of my life, music.
Thank you both so much for joining me. Very interesting guests. Plenty of inspirational words.
Yeah.
See you guys next time. Thank you for joining me. Can't wait for the next time. Bye.
Stay happy. Bye-bye. Thanks, Barrie.
Yeah, that'd be great.